Welcome to worship with Centennial United Methodist Church at Ivy. Today is a very warm and humid summer Iowa day, but it is a great day to worship God. So thank you for joining us today. If you are worshiping with us online, please let us know. Say hello to your neighbors who are joining you. Let us know that you're worshiping with us. And if you're worshiping outside in the parking lot, will you let us know that you can hear us by honking your horn for us? Nope. Anybody can hear me? Oh, now I hear some honks. Can you honk your horn if you can hear me today? Can you hear me? No. Okay. Well, I hope that they can hear us. We're going to turn this up. Good morning, everyone. I hope you can hear us. Eric, do you mind going and checking with folks who are out in the parking lot and see if they can hear us? We want to make sure that everybody who's here worshiping with us can hear us today. I'm going to share some announcements with you about... Maybe with our door shut, we can't hear them honking, but... I'm going to share some announcements with all of you about what we have going on. We're a busy church right now. If you are worshiping from home, oh, now we can hear some honking horns. Good. If you are worshiping from home, you can find our bulletin on our website. It's ivycentennial.org. This past week, on Wednesday, we had an incredibly successful food drive with 907 pounds of donations that we sent in, and that equaled 1,288 items. So that is an incredible success from all of us and from our neighbors, and I am giving immense thanks for the work of all of us as we donated that many items. I'm just in awe, and I have no words to express how thankful I am. Another announcement is that on Saturday, August 15th, so a week from yesterday, we are sending some volunteers from 9 to 11 a.m., just 2 hours to go serve at Meals from the Heartland. And Rita Denhart is outside today. She's available if you'd like to sign up for that. If you want to carpool from the church next Saturday, just meet at the church at 8:15, but be sure that you sign up ahead of time. And speaking of Meals from the Heartland, this week we received a thank you note from them because while Pastor Dwayne was here last fall, you all donated your coins to a very heavy bucket or jar, and that jar ended up being a donation of $495. And so Meals from the Heartland says thank you so much for this gift. They said this gift will be used to purchase ingredients for our annual hunger fight, and they said hopefully you can come help us pack meals. Well, their hope is coming true because we're doing that next Saturday, so please sign up with us. Other announcements. Next Sunday, I hope you'll join us. If you are a student of any age, or if you're a teacher, you're returning back to school, or you work in a school, bring your backpack next Sunday. We're going to bless those backpacks for this school year. That's going to be a very interesting one. And we'll have little pins that you can put on your backpack so that you know each day that you look at your backpack this school year that it has been blessed and that you have been blessed for this work that you're about to embark on. And lastly, one more announcement. This is kind of in the future or ways into the future, but Wednesday, September 16th, we are planning for that day to be our rally day. It's going to be a rally day in the era of COVID, so it's going to be pretty different. We're looking at just having a bonfire with a short worship service as a part of that. So come Wednesday, September 16th, or at least put that on your calendar from 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. And more information will come out soon. So those are our many announcements. Let's read together our centering quote as we center ourselves into worship this morning. Here's our centering quote. It comes from Henry Nouwen. And it relates to our sermon series that we've been talking about through the months of July and August, this series as we reflect on fear and what it means to live unafraid. So here's Henry Nouwen's quote. He says, "Much violence is based on the illusion that life is a property to be defended and not to be shared." May it be so. Let's say together our call to worship as we begin this worship together. Holy One, you choose the very least and raise us up to greatness. For nothing is impossible with God. You take the weak, the poor, and blind and raise us out of the margins. For nothing is impossible with God. You call us to take risks for the sake of your kingdom. Help us accept your call to serve your world, to compassionately love your people, to offer support rather than to spread fear, and to confidently offer thanksgiving for your greatness. So may we answer your call saying, "I am the Lord's servant. Here I am. Send me. Amen." Let's sing together our first hymn. It's hymn number 632, "Draw Us in the Spirit's Tether." So that we can lift them up to God in this space, and so that you may also keep these people in your personal prayers this week. We ask for continued prayers for Bob and Dee Johnston. Bob is in the hospital again this week, and he has not been doing well. Because of the coronavirus, Dee is not able to visit him. So we offer prayers for both of them in this difficult time. We pray for the family and friends of Reverend Bill Cotton, one of Ivy's previous pastors. Bill died on Monday, August 3rd, after many years of service to God and God's people. May God's love surround all who grieve and give thanks for Bill's life. We ask for prayers for Forrest Kidman, Janice and Ardeen Williams' 21-month-old great-grandson, who is currently receiving care at the pediatrics ICU at Blank Children's in Des Moines after he was found drowned on Tuesday this last week. He has a heartbeat. His tests currently reveal that many of his organs are at 100% function levels. And so we continue to offer prayers for those who are caring for him, his family, and we ask for prayers that his body and brain make a full recovery. We continue to ask for prayers for Jim Denhart, who has not felt well, particularly in recent weeks, and as he continues to receive treatment from doctors and medical staff. May his doctors find answers to help him have a truly full recovery, and may God bring comfort and care to his family, including Rita. We continue to pray for a friend of Joni Musselman's, who is working hard at getting healthy enough to get on the transplant list for a new kidney. We pray that her spirits will be lifted, that she may find courage in this time to care for herself in order to also receive the care that she needs. We continue to pray for people in and connected to our community who continuously receive chemo treatments for diagnoses that they received in the past year, including Cindy, a cousin of the Jackson family, Kathy Johnston, who is Bob and Dee Johnston's daughter-in-law, and Nancy Dorrell. May God's love surround them as they receive more tests and treatment. We ask for prayers for Sherry Malley, who is a friend of Maggie Stout. Sherry had a successful hip replacement surgery a week ago on Friday, and we pray that she will continue to have a healthy recovery. We continue to pray for the family and friends of Aunt Louise, including Maggie Stout. Louise Stout died a few weeks ago, and we are in prayer for Louise's daughter, her grandchildren, and great-grandchildren as they grieve her death. We pray also for those who will miss her presence at Woodlands Retirement Community in Clive. We continue to lift up Maggie Stout's neighbor, who is in the sixth grade, who has been undergoing cancer treatments for some time now. We continue to pray that her scans are clear so that she can be on the road to recovery. We continue to pray for Kathy Kane and her family. Kathy is the family friend of the Jackson family, and she recently had surgery for a brain tumor. So we continue to lift her up in our prayers as she begins a new treatment plan. And this week especially, we still pray for the teachers, administrators, students, and families who are making tough decisions at this time for the safety of their communities and themselves as school starts up again soon. And we ask for prayers for Colton Hyatt, who is Sandra Stewart's grandson. He will be returning home this week from BASIC in South Carolina, and so we pray for his safe return and safe travels. These are the prayers of our community that we lift up. And most weeks I say something like, we offer these prayers and the prayers kept silently in our hearts. And this week I had a couple of people who sent me a message saying, I don't know how to word this prayer, but they tell me what's going on. And that reminded me, when folks said that to me, that reminded me how essential it is that each time we come to prayer, we remember that God knows our prayers before we know how to knit them together in a perfect sentence. God knows the prayers on our hearts. And so we trust that today as we come together and join together in prayer. Holy God, in our times of weakness and in our moments of need, yours is the strength by which we find comfort, love, and support to carry on. When our load is heavy and too much to bear, yours are the arms stretched out to help us and the grace that we depend on. Lord, some weeks seem too complicated. Some weeks feel like they're too much to handle. some weeks in the pandemic, they're exhausting. As we pray over and over again for the healing of our world, the safety of our loved ones, the health of our public, and yet the numbers climb, and we fear the control that this virus has taken on our world. But Lord, help us hear your loud voice over and over again, for as long as it takes for us to internalize. May we hear your voice saying to us, come and find rest. Help us to receive your call, your divine grace, so that we may tread the path to wholeness in body and in spirit, finding you along and at the end of the path. For the rest you offer and the call you give us to serve this world, Lord, we give you immense thanksgiving. So as we receive your call to lean further into our discipleship and to find rest in you, may we say the prayer Christ taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. For the past 5 weeks or so, we've been on this sermon series called Living Unafraid. And for those first 5 weeks, we focused on Old Testament passages and stories of different people throughout the Bible that experienced fear. And today we begin what we will study for the next few weeks, which are New Testament stories. So today let's hear the word from Luke chapter 1. When Elizabeth was 6 months pregnant, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a city in Galilee, to a virgin who was engaged to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David's house. The virgin's name was Mary. When the angel came to her, he said, Rejoice, favored one, the Lord is with you. She was confused by these words and wondered what kind of a greeting this might be. The angel said, Don't be afraid, Mary. God is honoring you. Look, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of David, his father. He will rule over Jacob's house forever, and there will be no end to his kingdom. Then Mary said to the angel, How will this happen since I haven't had sexual relations with a man? The angel replied, The Holy Spirit will come over you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the one who is to be born will be holy. He will be called God's Son. Look, even in her old age, your relative Elizabeth has conceived a son. This woman who was labeled unable to conceive is now 6 months pregnant. Nothing is impossible for God. Then Mary said, I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me just as you have said. Then the angel left her. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. All praise to the living word. Let's reflect on these gifts we receive from Scripture by singing hymn number 156, I Love to Tell the Story.
I love to tell the story because
you join me now in a moment of prayer? Holy One, we love to tell the story, the old, old story, of Jesus and his love. Help us today to hear the words you want us to hear as we continue to faithfully share your story with the world. Amen. One of the biggest risks that I've ever taken happened just this last fall in October of 2019. Eric and I were preparing for the long-awaited return to Iowa as we awaited the day that we would return and serve alongside this community here at Centennial. We took a week off in October to travel here to Des Moines and search for our very first house that we would call our own. We searched and visited dozens of homes in the matter of 5 days. From Urbandale to Johnston, from Altoona to Pleasant Hill, we searched all over the Des Moines Metro. But at the end of the week, after putting in offers at multiple homes and coming up short each time, we unfortunately returned to Texas with 7 or 8 weeks left of living in Texas, with the reality that we did not find a home as we had hoped. When we returned to Texas, my parents graciously offered to continue looking at houses for us, but we never had heard of such a process. So while we were grateful, we were still a bit skeptical that we'd find positive results. For a few weeks, almost each night after work, my parents would meet with our realtor and visit 2 or 3 homes while they FaceTimed us on their phone, showing us each house through FaceTime. Finally, after a couple of weeks, my parents visited a house in North Beaverdale. The house had beautiful hardwood floors, a finished basement, and a large backyard, which we desperately needed for Dolly. But the kitchen, while still functional, had bright aqua blue cabinets with orange walls and red stars wrapped around the walls near the ceiling. My mom kindly encouraged me to remember paint isn't terribly expensive, and I could look past the color scheme that the previous owner curiously picked. While I struggled a bit with the kitchen, it was the first house that Eric fell in love with, and we decided to put an offer in on the house. While I'll spare you some of the more dramatic details of our house purchase, I realize now how this may have been the biggest risk I had ever taken. Let me restate this in case it's not clear yet. Eric and I put an offer in on a house, our first house, an offer that stated we wanted to purchase the largest and most expensive item we would ever buy, maybe other than our education, and we'd never even step foot in the place. And after about a day or so, the seller accepted our offer, and it would still be 6 weeks until one of us saw the house in person. When I say that out loud, I just feel really silly that we bought a house without seeing it in person. I'm still in shock that not only we bought a house without seeing it, but that we love the house and that it's been practically a perfect fit for us the moment we finally saw it, almost 2 months after we put our first offer in. And by the way, I don't tell you the story to recommend this way of purchasing a home. But our lives are filled with risk. Sure, some actions are more riskier than others, like buying a house without seeing it in person, but we're constantly living in the midst of moments where we find ourselves choosing to take or not to take risks. We encounter risk when we accept the invitation to attend a new church, or if we enter into a marriage. What if we get hurt by someone we meet at the church? What if our marriage ends in divorce, like 50% of marriages do? Jobs often require risk too, and even more so in this season. Doctors, nurses, and other hospital staff encounter risk every time they enter the hospital, Will they be exposed to the coronavirus? Will their work put their family in danger? Or firefighters and police officers who answer calls to unsafe situations? What if they get injured or worse, lose their life for the safety of another person? Besides jobs, we encounter risk when we choose to enter into parenthood, or when we choose to give our money, our time, our energy to a church. What if we give our money away and now we're unable to pay for the groceries or the bills later? Regardless of the situation, if we want to live a well-lived life, we will inevitably encounter risk. I'm convinced that fear is what makes certain actions or decisions risky. We're afraid of making mistakes, so it's a risk to be in relationship with other humans who might witness the mistake I made. We're afraid of getting hurt, so it's a risk to open up and share intimacy with a friend or a potential partner. We're afraid of not being or really feeling in control of a situation, so it's a risk to take a job where I'm not the boss, or to volunteer for a service opportunity where I receive instructions from someone else. We let our fears get in the way of trying new opportunities, creating new relationships, and simply living our lives. Our scripture text, while it may not seem at first glance, it includes an enormous amount of risk. We find Mary, a young woman preparing to get married, encountering an angel who informs her not only that she's pregnant out of wedlock, but pregnant with the actual Son of God. Her encounter with the angel, while scripture may not inform its readers, has everything to do with risk. It's likely that Mary is 13 or 14 years old when she's informed of her pregnancy. A woman in the first century Jewish culture who becomes pregnant out of wedlock faces great danger. It's inevitable that she will encounter public shame or humiliation. Perhaps she'll be shunned as she appears to have brought shame to her family. That is, of course, if she says yes to the angel's request. Beyond how others perceive her, we know how the story continues, and it's drenched in risky situations. While the text tells us that God is honoring Mary, she is far from a life of ease. Sure, God honors her, but when she arrives in her fiancé's hometown to give birth, they realize there's no place other than a stable for her to give birth to God's son, a place that only people who were homeless would do. Sure, God honors Mary, but after she gives birth to Christ, she, her husband, and her newborn baby will be forced out of Bethlehem and forced to live as refugees in Egypt after the king finds her child threatening and endangers their lives. The risks Mary is about to face when she receives this message from the angel makes a purchase on a home one has never seen before look a bit trivial. Yet Mary, in the face of fear and risk, accepts her call from God anyway. She knows very little at this point about what she says yes to, and yet she says yes anyway. Mary claims her status as the Lord's servant in the midst of fear and risk. Her claim and acceptance reveals how she is unwilling to live a life of luxury and perceived safety for her own purposes when God clearly has called her to more, even if she experiences uncomfortability, even if she is outcast, shamed, and belittled, even if she spends her entire life trying to protect her son from harm's way. God doesn't promise Mary or us a life free of hardship. When God calls us into discipleship, we can guarantee it will not be a life free of harm's way or free of sacrifice. We follow a God whose sacrificial love reveals that a Christ-centered life is not free from adversity. Like Mary, we're called to receive God's call in the face of risky outcomes and to say, "I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me just as you have said." The last five words of our scripture today, they inform us what happens immediately after Mary affirms God's call to her and says yes. Luke tells us, "Then the angel departed from her." This really doesn't give us much information. It doesn't tell us what Mary knew at this point. But it seems likely that the only thing she could guarantee from this encounter is that her saying yes would be risky. Moments after we say yes to God, we might second guess our decision as the certainty wavers. When the prayer ends, the moment after we have said yes, this is where Mary is left at the end of our scripture today. Saying yes doesn't rid her or us of mystery. In fact, this is the moment when mystery begins. While mystery and the unknown is uncomfortable and it's likely full of risk, it's also where we have the capacity to find God, likely because we're constantly searching for answers to our discomfort. While we may never know what Mary knew, I imagine she, like us, knew just enough in her conversation with the angel to get started. Thankfully, Mary's yes, in the midst of risk and fear and the unknown, ended up changing the world. Many of the blessings in our lives, like Mary's story, they begin with a bit of risk and mystery. When we say yes to parenthood, we exist in the unknown, arguably forever, as we have no idea what the future of this child holds, and yet we say yes anyway. When we enter into a new career or a new stage in our life, say retirement, there's no way of telling if we truly will be as happy as we are in this stage of our life. Are we willing to risk financial security for rest? Are we willing to risk the comfortable for what may temporarily be uncomfortable? We have no idea what our future may hold, and yet we say yes anyway. Every time we come to the church, we find ourselves with a bit of mystery, unsure what we'll encounter this time. If we have a new minister, will she truly encourage us, or will she attempt to diminish the work we're already doing? What if we come to find a neighbor at church who says something that hurts us, or we disagree with a decision made by a committee? What if we try worshiping through the radio or online and it's not exactly the same as before? Regardless of the relationships we engage in, there's likely a measure of risk involved because we encounter mystery and lack of control everywhere we go. And yet, when we answer yes, we might just find blessings. Even if we struggle with the new minister, or we disagree with another church member, or we don't agree with a decision made by a committee, we can choose to spend time in worry, or some have chosen to leave for the sake of mystery and risk is too uncomfortable. But if we leave too early, have we diminished our answer to God when we first answered yes to come and be in relationship with others? What if we never said yes to starting the new job that led to a lifetime of friendships for ourselves and our family? What if we never said yes to that adoption, or to that marriage, or to that friendship, or to that church, because it was too uncomfortable to live without knowing, to live without certainty? Maybe we could have lived a life with less heartache or grief or struggle or risk. But did we choose to truly live with the same courage and faith that Mary chose when she faithfully answered, "Yes, I am the Lord's servant"? Friends, I pray today that we will, today and every day, that even when we come face to face with risk, that we will faithfully say yes anyway, trusting that someday our faithfulness might amount to something even half as grace-filled and world-changing as Mary's yes did for her family and our world. May it be so. Amen. This is the time in our worship service when we extend our worship into a time of giving. So if you're with us worshiping on the radio, we have Galen who is here. He has a basket that you're available to put your offering in. If you're worshiping with us online, or even if you're on the radio and you'd like to give today, you can give online or send your gifts in the mail. This past week we offered something as a community, and that was 907 pounds of items and donations. That was 1,288 items that we donated. That's a part of our offering today and this week. Let's see if we can do something extraordinary this upcoming week as well. As we spend this time in offering, let's listen to a hymn sung by our wonderful leaders today. Prayer together as our prayer over our offering this day. Almighty God, please help us hear your call to take risks, to make sacrifices, and do what is inconvenient for the sake of your kingdom of love. Help us remember that it is in pursuing these risks that we find your greatest blessings. And may you give us the courage to respond to your call with Mary's words, confidently saying, I am the Lord's servant, let it be with me just as you have said. Amen. Amen. Let's sing our last hymn together. We all are one in mission. Second verse, it starts with, "We all are called for service to witness in God's name." That's what we did this last week, and I am just in awe of the extraordinary service you have offered your community. And you also have an opportunity to do that this Saturday with us as we go and serve at Meals from the Heartland. And it's what our leaders here have done today. We've got Linda, Eric, Evan, Galen, and Missy who have been here helping us today. And for those of you who are here trying out worship online or on the radio, that all of that is something to give thanks for. And it's doing service in God's name. And I thank you for that. So as we go from this place, may you receive now this benediction. May the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you until we meet again. And may we accept our call from God with Mary's courage, not to stay comfortable, but to take risks for the sake of grace. Amen. Go in peace. I'll see you soon.